Hi everyone, welcome to the very first Facebook Live interview at the Independent Women's Forum. I'm your host, Erica Anderson, and we want to thank you for joining us today as we speak with New York Congresswoman Elise Stefanik. Thank you so much for joining us, Congresswoman.
Thank you, Erica. I'm so excited to be here.
So for those of you who don't know, Congresswoman Stefanik is the youngest person ever elected to Congress in the history of the United States. So can you tell us, did you ever imagine that you would hold that title?
Well, I'm so honored to be the youngest woman ever elected to Congress. I actually didn't know that when I was first running for office, and I found out after I won my primary. So it was a wonderful surprise, but it's been incredibly humbling. There are still so many women, both in my district but across the country, who reach out to my office, who are really looking for role models. So I've tried to do the best job I can at showing young women that you can add your voice, to have the courage to step into the arena and share your viewpoints. But it's just been an amazing experience. Something interesting started happening when the media started covering that fact. Parents would bring their young daughters, and these a lot of times were families that would never go to political rallies or political events. They were Republicans, Democrats, Independents, but they wanted to show their daughters a role model of what they could achieve in anything that they do. So I pinch myself every day that I have the opportunity to be a role model for the next generation of women leaders.
And when people do come to you, you know, with those kinds of questions and those kinds of dreams, what do you tell young women who do aspire to run for political office someday?
I tell them they should do it. It's interesting. When I first thought about running for Congress, I was 28 years old, and I started the process of talking to local leaders, community leaders, business owners, economic developers throughout upstate New York. And, you know, I think at first blush, they thought it was going to be almost impossible for someone who was young to run for office and successfully win a congressional seat. But I found that my youth ended up really being a strength in that process. People are looking for new ideas and a new generation of leadership. So I often talk to young women and tell them that it's okay that you don't look like the typical congressional candidate or the typical member of Congress. The average age of a member of Congress is 60, and I cut that in half. Running. So we're really talking about two generations, but you can talk about your experience, whether it's as a mom, whether it's running a business. There are so many just amazing women in my district who are, you know, running their family's farm, who are starting businesses, who are raising kids, who are teachers. That perspective is incredibly important as we have these larger political discussions across the country.
And you're able, as someone who is younger and who is a woman, you're really able to reach a new demographic that a lot of those older congressmen and women are not able to reach. So it's actually better if you can get in there at a younger age, it almost seems like.
Well, that's what been one of my efforts is I started the Millennial Task Force, and I'm having a hearing later today, actually, about millennial opportunities in hydropower, which is obviously a renewable energy opportunity, mm-hmm. really important in upstate New York. But the purpose of the Millennial Task Force is to educate my colleagues in Congress of the importance of engaging with the millennial generation. As of 2015, millennials are the largest generation in our workforce, and we're changing what our workforce looks like. We're the most educated generation. We're also the most diverse generation, and we face unique problems, whether it's historic student debt or whether it's saving for purchasing a home. So I like to educate my colleagues about the importance of engaging with the millennial generation.
And let me ask you this, and you may or may not have experienced this, but have you ever experienced a lack of respect due to your age or even your gender being in Congress and being of a different demographic than most of those working with you?
You know, it's an interesting question. When I was first running, I definitely had experiences like that with people just that didn't think it was possible for me to win a primary and general election. But after my election, I've really been embraced by my colleagues in Congress. I can't speak highly enough about how encouraging they have been, and that goes across the aisle as well. It's interesting. I mentioned the average age of a member of Congress is approximately 60. I think many of them see their kids in me, mm-hmm. in the sense that they see their kids succeeding and working really hard in a challenging economy today. And they are very hopeful about what our future generation can bring in terms of new ideas as we discuss really big issues at the national level. So I've been embraced. I've been encouraged. I've worked doubly hard. I try to always outwork and be very prepared when I go to my committee hearings, when I have constituent meetings. But I can't say enough how welcoming my colleagues have been. The one funny story after my election, I was going through the orientation process, which you're familiar with, Erica. After you're elected, all the new members come to Washington to pick their offices and get their committee assignments and really learn the lay of the land. And the Capitol Police didn't believe I was a member of Congress, and they escorted me down the Capitol steps.
Oh my gosh.
Bottom, they looked at, you know, that was before we get our pin. They looked at my tag and they said, "Oh my gosh, you're the young member. You can go on these steps." So once we got over those issues, it's been fine.
That's pretty funny. I bet they felt not super smart after that.
They're great. I'm friendly with all the Capitol Police. They have a really tough job with the thousands of people in and out of the Capitol, but it is sort of a joke.
Yes. Oh, I could see that. So I've got to get your take on a couple of hot issues. We know right now that healthcare is the big thing in the news right now. But, of course, it seems like there's a ton of misinformation out there. You have it coming from the left and from the right. And with, you know, fake news always out there, what do you see as a misperception maybe about the Republican effort to replace the Affordable Care Act? And how do you correct that misperception that is coming from the left and coming from the media?
So it's a great question, Erica. I find that the substance often gets lost in the debate. And details matter when you're dealing with one-fifth of our domestic economy. The fact of the matter is Obamacare is failing. We're continuing to see double-digit increases in premiums. We're continuing to see people not having choices when they go on their exchanges in their states. One-third of the counties across this country only have one choice on the Obamacare exchange. So I think it's important that we talk about the details and not just the top line, which so often gets portrayed both on network news and in the media. What I've tried to do is highlight really broken aspects of the Affordable Care Act. The Affordable Care Act included tons of taxes, whether it's the medical device tax, whether it's the health insurance tax. And that's something that has an impact on families across the country when they are struggling under increases in healthcare costs. I was back in my district last week during our district work period, and people need to have relief. They need to have better options and more affordable, accessible healthcare. I've engaged in bipartisan discussions on this. I've engaged in discussions with my Republican colleagues. But we need to frankly have a relief package for American families who are struggling with lack of access to healthcare because the costs continue to rise.
And how do you think Americans should kind of rise above the rhetoric that comes out of various publications and on social media? Because policy is complicated, right? And some people just don't know where to get the best information on the policies that are coming out of our government. Do you have any recommendations on the best way to stay informed in a non-biased way?
I think the best way to stay informed is to educate yourself by looking at both sides of the issue. So whether it's going to outside think tanks or associations on one side of the debate or the other side of the debate, so you can really compare yourself what your position is, or whether you believe that we need to repeal and replace, or whether you believe we need to stick with the Affordable Care Act. Again, I try to get to the facts of the matter, and that is looking at the lack of choices in counties across the country, looking at the increases in cost, hearing firsthand from constituents who are struggling with the increases of the ACA. But we also, you know, I also acknowledge there are parts that are working, keeping young people on their parents' plan until the age of 26, providing coverage for those with pre-existing conditions. But I think looking at both sides of any issue is important as Americans. And that's one of the frustrating aspects I find if you look at this last election cycle. Too often, voters were only talking to like-minded voters. And I see that with groups across this country. It was interesting, last night on 60 Minutes, there was a piece that had half Trump voters and half Clinton voters from the state of Michigan. And actually having that discussion makes our country in a better place because we're able to hear each other other's perspective instead of being siloed into one viewpoint.
Right. And that actually leads me to my next question, which is that you are known for kind of working with Democrats across the aisle sometimes as a moderate. It's a label that's not always easy to navigate, but perhaps something we need more of right now in Washington. How do you maintain the priorities of your constituents and keep the party happy?
Well, I am a Big Tent Republican. I am a new generation Republican. I think we need to modernize how we talk about issues, and we need to modernize our solutions for the 21st century. I said when I was running, I'll work with anybody if they have a good idea, no matter what their party affiliation is. So that's me keeping my promise to my constituents. Some of my colleagues that I work closest with are across the aisle, whether it's on the Education and Workforce Committee. I've been very active with my colleague Suzanne Bonamici on a number of issues regarding K-12 education. I worked on modernizing Pell Grants to make them year-round. To me, that actually is fiscally conservative in the sense that if students are able to take college classes year-round, they can graduate faster and take out less student loans. That got bipartisan support, and it was signed into law by President Trump as part of a legislative package. So I think people are looking for solutions, and part of that is reaching across the aisle when you're able to.
Yeah, I think you have the right idea on that, and finding those issues where people can come together bipartisanly, because it's obviously been so divisive in this country lately. And you mentioned a couple issues that you have focused on outside of healthcare and tax reform. What other issues do you think aren't getting enough attention these days?
I've been very focused on issues related to military families. In my district, I represent Fort Drum, which is home to the 10th Mountain Division, the most deployed unit in the U.S. Army since 9/11. And I actually represent the highest number of veterans out of any congressional district in New York State. So I've been very focused on VA reform efforts, but I think what has not gotten a lot of focus at the national level is our military spouses and military families. I've introduced legislation that will be included in the National Defense Authorization Act. It was included, it passed the House, and we're going to conference with the Senate to allow the same tax benefits for spouses, to allow, if you have a professional certificate, let's say you're a teacher and you have to transfer with your spouse from one state to another because you're changing your military base, making sure that you don't have to get recertified and have to pay that significant cost out of pocket, covering that up to $500. I've also introduced legislation supporting our military caregivers. There's a military caregivers program in the VA that has a significant backlog that didn't anticipate the number of applicants. And I want to streamline and modernize that program so the benefits actually get to the caregivers. There is so much more work to be done regarding our military families. And most of those ideas came directly from the spouses and military families themselves. So a lot of it is just about listening to your constituents.
Yeah, that's awesome. Coming directly from the people that are being affected, and another issue that certainly could be supported bipartisanly across the aisle. Lastly, I have one more question. We are the Independent Women's Forum, so I want to ask a question about our Working for Women commitment, which you signed last year, and you were honored at our banquet. This commitment, it emphasizes the importance of a flexible workplace, scheduling, equal opportunities, women in business, and positive tax reforms for families so they can save more money. What motivates you to stand behind policies like these?
I think as a young woman, we're seeing the workplace change. My peers are breaking through glass ceilings in so many different industries, and we're really juggling raising families, making healthcare decisions on behalf of our family, both for our children, but also for our elderly parents. So many of these economic issues, every economic issue impacts women. And I think what Independent Women's Forum is doing is continuing that conversation and putting forth creative policy ideas that really reflect today's workforce. So I'm really excited about the initiative that Independent Women's Forum has put together. I know my colleagues in Congress, my fellow women Republicans in Congress, are also committed to continuing these conversations so that our policies reflect the 21st century.
All right. Well, thank you so much for coming on today, Congresswoman. We appreciate your time. Thank you so much for our inaugural Facebook Live interview. And thanks to everyone watching. We'll see you next time on Facebook Live.